Are you sitting comfortably? Are you ready for the gig of the weekend? I want to hear you at the back there. I want to hear you on the park stage, live from the shadow of St. Michael's Spire and the ancient Tor, shrouded in the hilly mists of the levels, pungent with wood smoke, blackened by corrupt dust, steeped in Arthurian legend, emboldened by the Kraken, Silver Radio Award-winning Community Garden Radio!
Can't go that far, actually, because it's not a very long flex. I'm going to service the other side in a minute. Come on!
Easy rider, easy rider. Come on, easy rider. Come on, easy rider. Come on, you know them. Come on now, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for coming to the Crow's Nest. Today, 1300 hours military.
It's quite loud, isn't it? Fucking hell, I feel like I'm being given birth to here. Shit the bed. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Community Garden Radio live from Glastonbury. I've just realised that I can't actually do the touch screen because I'm wearing a silver bodysuit. Do you understand why I'm wearing the silver bodysuit? Because, of course, we are silver award winning, us guys. Not gold. Fuck that. Craig Charles got a gold, actually. He's here somewhere. He's coming up in a bit. Ladies and gentlemen.
Coming up on the show today, we have guests, including
Music's Matt Everett, in conversation with a member of the royal family. Don't worry if you've got teenage children here, it is not Prince Andrew, okay? We also have, I was going to say body popping then, but that's not right. Beatboxing from Shlomo! They're going to be with us imminently. This is so hot, it's unbelievable. I think I've done 2 pounds already. And a musical guest. The heart and soul of Glastonbury, ladies and gentlemen. He's going to walk up that hill, or maybe he's going to get copted, I don't know. Billy Bragg! I am going to play... Let me rephrase that. Ben is going to play a song while I get out of this body stocking. Thank fuck for that. And then after that, let's regroup. Thanks for coming, everybody. That's not the end. That's the beginning. Come on, John. What should we start with? Let's have a look. Sorry, listeners at home. I've taken my glasses off as well. Get it on, T-Rex. There you go. Get it on, T-Rex. Why are we playing Get It On, T-Rex? Why are we playing Get It On, T-Rex? T-Rex. Anybody? Any runners of riders? First Glastonbury. Thank you very much indeed, Station Manager Clive. They played the first Glastonbury, ladies and gentlemen. 1970 T-Rex. Here they are. We Get It On. That was Rick Wakeman who does the glissando on that. You know that?
Get it on, bang a gong, get it on. and gentlemen, welcome to Community Garden Radio Live from Glastonbury. Can you just give me an indication as to your wellness? On a scale of 1 to 100? No, that's too complicated. Are you all feeling great? Yeah! Is anybody, let's take a little inventory, is anybody on like a prescription drug, like a Xanax at the moment? Nervous laughter all round. I don't even know where you get that stuff, you know, over here. That's why I love going to America. I always take an empty suitcase for all the prescription shit you can get for free out there. Well, not free, obviously. Anybody, let's see, it's just gone 1 p.m. I'm guessing a few of you are probably two ciders or lagers down. Anybody three? Oh, okay. That's where the trouble's going to come from in 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Anybody enjoyed a cheeky jazz cigarette? Okay. Now, you remember, back in the 70s, actually, advised that we played, we started with T-Rex there. They used to throw joints at the talent. And we don't disagree with that idea here. Just make sure that it's not like that hydroponic shit. This would be a really interesting second half. I'll tell you what, why don't we have a little bit, let's have a really familiar bed. Yeah. John Nettles, ladies and gentlemen. Still with us? Bill with us, not still with us. And for those that you, how many people here are, patrons of Community Garden Radio, can you show yourselves? So a big hello and a colossal thank you to you. How I wish you were there. Thank you for coming. But for all the people that aren't patrons of this radio program, this is going to be fucking weird. But effectively, what it is. It's a hubristic endeavour. We try to do a live radio programme in the middle of Glastonbury. I know, it's a fucking stupid idea, isn't it? But, you know, we embolden it with guests, we embolden the stock with... And what we've started to do, I hope you've noticed, is we've started to incorporate costume, which I think deserves a small cheer. I mean... Greg James doesn't wear a silver fucking bodysuit before he does his breakfast show. I can tell you that for nothing. And one of the things that we are going to do today is we're going to play a round of Community Garden Radio Bingo. Okay, so a little ripple of applause for producer Ben, who's among us. Thank you also to Kitty, to station manager Clive, to Vibes woman Becky. To this colossally brilliant crew at the Crow's Nest. Can we just have a little ripple for them as well? But we need a special hurrah for all the community gardeners who can't be with us. 1, 2, 3, hurrah! But one of the things that producer Ben is doing right now, apart from showing off his incredible fucking pins, I was 28 once, he's handing out bingo cards, okay? Now, what you will notice written on the bingo card, and it was incredibly difficult to get that algorithm on the computer to get 100 different cards. When you hear any Keaveney-style bingo, any classic clips or any things that, if I say the word apposite, for instance, or if, for instance, you hear Paul McCartney throwing a brick through John Lennon's window, like this, for instance.
McCartney! Who the hell do you think you are?
If you've got McCartney, tick it off. You know? If you've got, for instance, oh, Percy, get off me, woman, tick it off, okay? If the person at the end who's got a full row, if you, obviously, traditionally you shout house. Can we have 1, 2, 3? House! Exactly. If somebody gets house, you shout that out. The person who wins at the end wins a very special prize, ladies and gentlemen. Woo! Absolutely. Isn't it a thrill? Who is Craig? Freya. Freya is handing out the big... Thank you so much to Freya for handing out the bingo cards. I did think you said Freya. But But otherwise, settle in. Wait for the guests. Wait for the gags. Don't wait for the gags. You'll be waiting all fucking afternoon. A couple of missives, though. Damien sent us a few Glastonbury-style jokes, if you'd like to hear them. He says, if I can get 10 people to get 100 people to get 1,000 people to get 10,000 people to give me 10 quid, I can buy the main stage at Glastonbury. It's called a pyramid scheme.
Onions.
I was trying to make it to the crow's nest, but I got waylaid by an acid-fueled orgy in the campsite. It's fucking intense.
Damn!
Didn't say they were good.
Damn!
What stage smells like your nan's lounge? The Glade. That was awful, Damien. That was truly awful. But in a serious way, thank you very much for making it up the hill, because I've just turned 51. Anybody in the 50s here? That's my demographic right there. Anybody in the teens? Oh, no, bollocks, Clive. In 1981, maybe. But it's hard to get up that hill in this weather, isn't it? It really is. We're in conversation with Michael and Emily Evis, and we're considering getting a Stana airlift for everybody up the hill next year, because we're all getting a bit older, aren't we? And what we think we might do, actually, next year is rename it. Instead of calling it the Crow's Nest, we're going to call it the Oxygen Tent. And we're just going to pump it full of oxygen. I think we'll be fine. Shall we have another song?
Yeah!
It's almost, it's a little bit like a shit disco. But instead of a man sort of going, all right, over the songs, he's talking for 5 or 6 minutes in between them. I think it'll catch on. So let's have a look.
Let's rock this thing.
Yeah, let's rock this thing. I know what we'll do next, ladies and
someone to kick you.
Come on!
know it's weird. We've got to settle into it. I said this last year. It's a little bit like watching somebody have bad sex do a live radio show. Have we got any voyeurs in? Yeah. Yeah. I used to live opposite. No, leave it. There are some stories you really shouldn't tell. Very, very soon, we're going to be joined by Billy Bragg, ladies and gentlemen. Fucking, I can't believe, I won't believe it until he actually turns up, to be completely honest. But he's apparently going to be here. So that's a colossal thrill. But in the meantime, has anybody got any on the bingo yet? Oh, yeah. Can I reveal what the actual, what the prize is going to be, Ben? It's going to be the last in existence dark grey Community Garden Radio t-shirt, extra large. You really might need that by Sunday, let's be honest. So that's all good, isn't it? Did you know? Has anybody actually... are the Arctic Monkeys definitely playing tonight? That's exciting. Dire Straits? Oh, right, sorry. There was a bit of selective hearing there, I think. And Guns N' Roses tomorrow, anybody fancy it? Splits the room, that. Did you know, I didn't know this. This is Slash is apparently called Slash because half, because his hat is in fact a fully waterproof piss receptacle for use in festival circumstances. If you see him in the fields this weekend, you need a piss, he will oblige. It's something you didn't know, isn't it? And, but also, if you get the fear this weekend, and it does happen, F-E-A-R, at Glastonbury, let's be honest, sometimes we overindulge, sometimes we don't hydrate ourselves enough, do we? Sometimes we have, you know, a little bit too much. So I've been offered to be gonged off in the green fields later on by a lovely Yorkshire woman, who I simply can't wait to meet. But you can have a bit too much of that kind of stuff. If you do get the fear, don't come to me for any kind of reassurance, okay? Reassurance is not something I do. I had a couple too many drinks about 2 weeks ago, and I actually, you know, you get the beer fear the day after. You're getting a little bit sweaty. You're getting a little bit panicky. You start to think about mortality. You start to think about your death. Is it just not just me? Is it? More or less. I was on a fucking bus, right? The worst place to be when you've got the fear, obviously. And I thought, I've got to talk myself down. And the way I talked myself down was, no shit. I said, Sean, don't worry. You're not about to die. You were only two-thirds of the way through the second third of your life if you live till you're 90. Didn't work. Horrifying thought. So let's forget about mortality. We're going to live forever. Come on. We're going to learn how to fly. That's my demographic right there. 1982 super hit from Irene Cara. And also, I just want to mention as well, Ben and I and Clive have been, you know, we're trying to diversify as much as we can. We're doing television shows and things like that. But I've also come up with, I've got quite a few sort of hipster types in here. So we're also going to venture into the crowded festival market, right? And here's my idea. I'm going for the sort of craft beer, hipster, East London, Six Music, Ethiopian, Flat White Brigade, right, for this. Hitting every nail on the head here. And it's a festival of booze, and it's called All Pints East, right? And it's set in a brewery in Shoreditch, right? And basically, you pay us £250 for a ticket, but you get as much strong beer as you can drink until such time as you vomit, are hospitalised, or shart yourself. And you don't need a tent because of the beer jacket. So there you go. Are you up for that? All right, it's a fucking brilliant idea. Is Billy imminent, do we think? He's not imminent. Oh, this is interesting. We might have to move our set list around a little bit, I think. I think we might have to move the set list around. And also, this is oversharing a little bit, but I am a little bit loose today. I think it might be the nerves. It might be the nerves. So I might have to excuse myself for a little moment, actually. Just round the back. For that, I apologise. But in the meantime, would you like to hear
Candy Staten's Nights on Broadway next, or Too Young by Phoenix?
Ooh, straight in with Phoenix. They're playing, aren't they? They're playing, aren't they? Or maybe they're not. Right, okay, we'll have this. I mean, this is ironic for us. What? Too Young.
Garden Radio at the top of the festival, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't get much better than this. It doesn't get much sweatier than this. Would you like to hear the keyboard player from Phoenix saying the words naughty boy?
Naughty boy.
One of the top eight sexiest people I've ever met, that guy. Just the keyboard player in Phoenix. It is no big deal. What a hot guy. As am I. Anybody else? Fucking hell, it's roasting up here. I'm going to come out into the audience, ladies and gentlemen. I need to share my sweat with you. So just one second. And also, we've actually got some live small claims here, ladies and gentlemen. Is there any small claims court Glastonbury special? Anybody seen anybody famous yet in Glastonbury Festival 2023? This gentleman saw Murray Lachlan Young, the poet. Murray, I don't know if you know this, I hope you're familiar with his work, but Murray Lachlan Young is essentially a poet stroke shaman. That's what he is. He will lay hands on you. He's not yet been prosecuted. Obviously, you have to ask. That goes without saying. But Murray usually arrives at the Glastonbury Festival in March. So, for those people that haven't seen the whole of Apocalypse Now, What you should instead do is just go and find Murray on Sunday night, look into his eyes, Colonel Kurtz. Oh, we've got a small claim, right? A little ripple of applause for this small claim, ladies and gentlemen. What is your name?
It's Jane.
Lovely Jane. Jane, are you as yet a Community Garden Radio patron?
No, I'm not, but I will be.
Jane says she's not, but she will be. We aren't doing this for financial purposes. We're doing it because of the fucking ley lines. All right. Jane, thank you very much in advance. You can cancel at any time. I'm making this corporate now. It's like the V97 now, isn't it, all of a sudden? Sponsored by Pepsi. Community Garden Radio, sponsored by Pepsi. And Nordoff Defence Dynamics. Jane, what is your small claim to fame?
Well, this is good. I caught an actually quite big carp in Murray Lachlan Young's pond.
Jane caught a very big carp in Murray Lachlan Young's pond, ladies and gentlemen. Small claims, good. Murray Lachlan Young carp special. Has he... Fucking hell, I didn't know he was doing that well. Has he got like a lake?
It's a pond.
Jane's like, it's a pond. Ponds, I mean, anything bigger than a big puddle is a pond, isn't it? Let's be honest. I mean, it's hardly Roger Daltrey, but it'll do. Jane, thank you very much. And we've got this young gentleman here. What is your name?
Osh.
Osh. Sorry, I can just stabilise myself on your lovely nut brown leg. That's inappropriate. I could have done that maybe 20 years ago, but not now. There's a form that you can fill in behind the scenes there. The lads will give it to you. What is your claim to fame, Osh?
I was once sworn at by Colin Farrell in a chicken shop.
Small claims court. Colin Farrell swore at me in a chicken shop special. What, can you give us a bit of context, though? Was it one of those KFC copy shops on Kilburn High Road?
It was a bit fancier than that. It's chicken sours, and I was working as a waiter. And yeah, he was there with his son, and he told us not to season the chicken with seaweed. And then he told us you better not fucking put the seaweed on the chicken. And then told me to fuck off.
No! That's just Carlin's way, though, isn't it? It's just lovely, twinkly Carlin's way. He's like, oh, fuck you. I will fuck you. That's what I'll do. Lovely chicken tenders. Stab with the fucking seaweed or I'll fuck you. That's not what Colin Farrell's like. That is... I mean, that's probably a prosecutable offence, that, what I've just done. Colin Farrell once walked past me as well. It's a true story, that. Absolutely true story. And the amount of times... I mean, I find it difficult to move around the festival, obviously. Constantly being stopped, propositioned, given drugs. And sometimes it's because people think it's me, Sean W. Keaveney, but most of the time it's because they think I'm Ryan fucking Reynolds or Ryan Gosling or Colin Farrell. That's the triumvirate. Oh, Colin, can we give you a joint? Will you have sex with my mate? No! I'm married. I'm not Colin Farrell. It's not 2014. Were it 2014, I might have taken advantage of those offers. Okay. Are you almost... By the way, you're right. You're very perceptive. You're right. That is a guitar, stage right. And I know what you're thinking. Jesus Christ, I hope Sean plays that guitar later. We're here in a sea of the greatest musical talent of all time. But what I really want to see is Sean playing the fucking guitar. Well, you're going to get your chance. Your dream's about to come true. But you've got to wait until the end of the show. Look at Pete Black sitting there like butter wouldn't melt. Fucking hell. By the way, sorry... In case minors are here, apologies for the swearing. I should have done that at the beginning of the show. Fuck that one up. Anyway, what we'll do is... This is funny as well. I've written a fucking set list with exact times on it. What a waste. What a waste of 10 minutes. What a waste of ink. That'll go on eBay. £65. Okay, what we'll do now is... I will... play another song, and then I think that there's a very good chance that on the other side of that, you're going to be seeing a legend up here. Not me. You are going to be in the presence of an actual Glastonbury stroke music legend. Imminently, we are going to be hearing from Billy Bragg. I know, I can't believe it, neither. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to play a little bit of Cure next.
You like to hear some Cure?
Yeah? Yeah? Of course you fucking would.
They played 7 times. Making that up, I don't actually know how many times they played.
Right, get a load of this, kids.
Go! Come on. Fucking hell, Robert Smith. Oh, it's because I've not put the favour up. I've only been doing this 23 years, you know. I'll get the hang of it eventually. Go to bed. It's Community Garden Radio here at the top of the Glastonbury Festival 2023. Has anybody got any more bingo? Is anybody close to getting a line? Not like that. Don't be like that. They should have checked all that when you came through the gates. You don't get a tick for shouting Craig Charles, you know. You don't get that. I think we'll get the details, but I think he's definitely playing Saturday night, I think. Just so you know.
Tops Direct.
Yeah.
Sean Bloody Keaveney.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Can I also thank Scott for bringing me the no traditional Kraken? Thank you, Scott. I do realise that it's a little bit like a sort of bad art piece sometimes watching live radio in a field. It's odd. It's a little bit like being at the Tate Modern or something, watching somebody performatively drink lager. But as well as the Red Stripe here, we should be sponsored by all of these people. Of course, we have to thank Andy for bringing us a can of the not delicious, but very refreshing.
Miguel, San Miguel, San Miguel.
In other words,
el especial bien frío. Aquí la tienes.
No, okay. Let's have a guest. A true... It's an understatement to say that we are beyond priapic to introduce this next person. A true musical, political lodestone, a firebrand, a polemicist, an activist, possibly affiliatist. I don't know if he collects stamps, we'll ask him. The goat of Glasgow, the bard of barking. Shall we brew up for Billy Bragg? It's so unbelievably exciting.
Sean, where are we, mate?
We are.
I got in the van to come up, and it went. I felt like that movie Apocalypse Now, but you've gone beyond the bridge at Dolong.
That's exactly the feeling, the vibe here, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't know where I was. All of a sudden, I saw the Glastonbury sign. I thought, surely not. We could be Shepton Mallet in a minute. I'm glad I didn't walk it. I'll tell you that, mate.
We coptered him in.
I'm glad I didn't walk here.
The horror.
I had a right old experience yesterday. I went to see my boy and his band were playing at the Avalon Cafe. That was all great. Went really well. But I made a classic Glastonbury mistake.
What did you do?
I gave me granddaughter a shoulders back all the way to left field.
For God's sake. How old is she? She's 18. That's the problem.
40, yeah. By the end, it felt like it. Yeah, it was great. It was great fun. And it's great that they're down and everything. But at the end of it, I was like, I'm not sure I should have done that. Not on the Thursday, maybe on the Sunday, not on the Thursday. But fortunately, what I
always say to my kids is that, look, I'm not going to keep a tab of everything you owe me, right?
Some
parents do that. You owe me £765,000.
Yeah.
Happy 18th.
Yeah.
But I am going to charge them for the osteopathy bills. Because they're bastards for that,
100%.
My eldest son, Arthur, when he was five or six, for about a year, he became Kato. You know, like in the Pink Panther films?
Yeah.
And he sort of, there was one week, I'd already got a really bad back and I was on diazepam, right? And I said to him, whatever you do, don't touch dad for a few days. And you know what he did? It's not a word of a lie.
Yeah.
When I wasn't looking, he climbed up on the couch behind me and jumped on my neck.
But I do love doing that. I mean, my son, you know, bless him, never was interested in football. So we'd go in the back garden and I'd roll the ball around for him and he would kick me so I'd fall over so he could jump on me. And that was his joy. So I used to do that. I never managed to get... Fortunately, we bonded over the Rolling Stones, so it wasn't the end of the world. Yeah.
What's the best Rolling Stones era, do you think?
I'm a really big fan of Exile on Main Street. I think it's just such a great, great record, such a great, great vibe. And to find that... In, you know, after all that time, you know, the Beatles broke up. Stones managed to come out the other end with Exile on Main Street. Although the thing we bonded over was actually a track from Sticky Fingers, which was Moonlight Mile. And I was driving and I said to him, check this bit out here where Keith plays the riff and the orchestra kind of joins in with Keith at the end here. You know, they're rocking with him. And we sat in silence. And he said, oh, that's amazing, Dad. And then I said to him, you know, son, I never had this conversation with my father. And he said, yeah, it's great, isn't it, Dad? And that was it.
Oh,
yeah, it was a lovely moment. Whenever I hear that track, I think of that. It's lovely, isn't it? It's nice to bond over that. It's just as well we didn't bond over West Ham because it would have been heartbreaking. up until the week before last, it would have just been years of misery. So,
I love that whole era of the Stones when they were recording Exile in Nelcut, in that sort of huge stately mansion in the south of France, and then they'd go out on speedboats.
Yeah.
And do you know score where, heroin.
Do you know where the Rolling Stones mobile? Do you know where it was the month before?
No.
It was outside Barking Town Hall in 1971. It was parked outside of Barking Town Hall because in Barking Town Hall there's the old, what used to be called the Assembly Rooms. It's called the Broadway Theatre now. But it had apparently the best acoustics for recording an orchestra as a whole, anywhere in London. The soundtrack for Psycho was recorded there, you know?
Barking Town Hall?
Yep. So the London Symphony Orchestra, I'm not kidding you, you can look this up. The London Symphony Orchestra, this is in February 1971, while I'm 13 years old and I'm in double physics. The London Symphony Orchestra are in Barking Town Hall recording live with Neil Young, A Man Needs a Maid. Incredible, isn't that incredible?
Why is this not public knowledge until Billy Bragg tells you?
I was there the other week unveiling the plaque. Neil Young made a movie of the making of Harvest. It's off that album Harvest, and he made a movie of the making of it, and they showed it as part of, they had a Neil Young Day over in Barking, and it's, they sort of showed the movie, and there he was. I couldn't imagine him walking around the downtown, you know, going into, there was a fabulous old style chip shop called the Pesky Brothers, Best Fish and Chips, when I was a kid. And I love the idea of him going in there with the order from the London Symphony Orchestra. I have 64 cod and chips, and I need, do you know what a Wally is, mate? I need 17 Wallys as well, and a Savaloy.
And can I, yeah, 71 Savaloys.
Yeah, under his hair, yeah.
If it's okay, I'm going to go to the Freeman Hardy Willis in the town centre and get some new boots.
Well, there was, I'll tell you what there was. Next to Barking Station when I was a 13-year-old, the hippest place in town was the Wimpy Bar. And that would be the only place you could get anything that might look like an American meal. And I see him in the Wimpy Bar. I mean, I know, also, there was a gig in Barking Dam called The Roundhouse. And when you look at the people who played it, Howlin' Wolf played The Roundhouse. I can imagine walking up Dagenham East Way on a Sunday afternoon before the gig looking for a bottle of scotch or something. It blows my mind.
I've got another one. I live right near Neasden Parade. You're probably ahead of me on this one. But it's actually where Bob Marley and the Wailers all had a house. And there's a blue plaque up there. Mm-hmm. And so they used to live in... That's apparently what Concrete Jungle's about.
Yeah.
It's not Kingston or anything. Neasden. It's about in Neasden. Yeah. If you've ever been there, the Dublin Hill Road, it's the road to hell. But also, Peter Tosh used to work in the grocers in Neasden Parade to make a bit of extra money.
He was selling bush.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
No, I can see him now. Big smoke everywhere. Paul, can I get you?
Excuse me, can I have one of those sweet potatoes, please?
Yes.
It's not a sweet potato, mate.
That's right.
You don't like a sweet potato.
That is not a banana.
No, your book about Skiffle, while we're on this, we just
that was a quick change.
This.
That was a...
Wasn't it? That was a whiplash job, that.
It was.
That's the kind of tone that I... That's why Radio 4 employ me a lot, you know.
And it's only Friday.
I can vault fast.
Skiffle.
From Peter Tosh's joint to Skiffle. But I just want to touch on this a little bit. Is it fair to claim that trad jazz enthusiast Ken Collier invented the Beatles?
Not quite. Not quite invented the Beatles, but he certainly was so obsessed with African-American roots music that he realised in the 1950s, he played in a trad jazz band. Now, trad jazz has a bad rap these days because it looks like, you know, sort of...
Kenny Ball.
Kenny Jazz and his ball band, yeah. and those guys. But actually, back in the late 40s and the early 50s, the trad guys were the hippest people because they were saying that the modern... not modern jazz, but the mainstream jazz, you know, the big bands had gone so far away from the jazz orchestras, had gone so far away from what it originally was, and that in order to really play jazz, you had to go back and listen to what they were doing in New Orleans around the turn of the century. It's like the Ramones saying, you know, Pink Floyd and that is rubbish, you could go back and listen to garage music. They were really hip. So he went to New Orleans, and he found these old guys who'd played on these amazing records in the 20s and 30s, and he sat in with them. But he also learned there while he was there about Lead Belly and Lead Belly's repertoire. And so this is a kind of really weird thing. Because he and his bandmates had learned how to play these songs by listening to records that were made in the 20s and 30s when the recording was just one mic. So all the performers on the old records really blew hard on their instruments to be heard. They really had to give it some. So consequently, the trad jazzers in Britain in the 40s, they thought that's how you played trad jazz. So they had no understanding of tone or timbre or anything. So they just blew the shit out of their instruments. After 30 minutes, their lips were so numb, they could barely speak. So that's when they put down their brass instruments, picked up guitars so people wouldn't leave, and played basically Lead Belly songs. And that skiffle kind of come out of that.
Skiffle and everything comes from that, doesn't it?
And I interviewed Pete Townsend from the book. And his dad was in a jazz band. His dad was a trombone player in a band called the Squadroneers. And he went to see this Ken Collier band. And he said there was a moment at this gig where the banjo player, who sits at the back of the stage because he's in the rhythm section, came to the front of the stage, picked up a guitar and took control of the gig. And he said, at that moment, I knew that my father's music was over and that this was the music of the future. And I went out and bought a guitar. And that's kind of what Skiffle did. It introduced the guitar into British popular music. Wow. Before... If you heard, you did hear guitar on the radio, but it would be played by an outsider. It would be played by someone from the Caribbean. It would be Calypso. It would be a blues man. It would be someone like Bill Brunsley, who used to come over. Or it would be a singing cowboy. Cowboys in those days all sung. But you would never have a British singer fronting a band playing a guitar. But Lonnie Donegan, who was in Collier's band, Lonnie Donegan changed all that when he came from the back of the stage, took to the front of the stage, played a Lead Belly song called Rock Island Lion, bit of boom, bit of bam, went and played in Liverpool after Rock Island Lion was a hit. George Harrison went all five nights. Paul McCartney went twice. John Lennon, we don't know if he went, but he formed his skiffle band a week after. So that's what Ken Collier did.
You know what I mean? You're in the Free University, by the way. You see, it's not just a man drinking lager in a grey body stocking. You're getting some musical education from Billy Bragg. It doesn't get better than that.
Yeah. It's like punk rock. I mean, skiffle is like punk rock. It's the ultimate DIY music. You know, basically they were playing washboards and T-chest basses. You know, everything that happened in punk that I remember in punk. When I wrote the book about skiffle, I went to have a look if it was there, and it was all there. Fanzines was there. Writing on your clothes was there. The only thing that wasn't there was amphetamines.
And it was only like, I don't know, like 25 years later or something, which is like 25
light years.
Yeah, 20 years.
It was only 20 years. I mean, peak skiffle, 1957. You know, the sales of acoustic guitars in the UK went from 1952, 5,000, to 1957, 250,000. And if you imagine, you know, divide that by five, that would be the number of bands they were playing. And they were almost all kids. They were almost all... Skiffle was like a school... a playground craze. There were no clubs. But those kids... All of them went on to join bands who followed the Beatles into America after the Beatles broke America. All those bands were all former skifflers. Right up to ABBA. Even ABBA used to be skifflers, you know?
No, you get fidget spinners. Then you got skiffle, rock and roll, and the rest of modern music and culture. You know, which would you rather have?
And also, it's really significant because that generation, the first generation, of defiant British teenagers... were desperate. I mean, they'd grown up. Rationing of food and clothing in this country didn't end until 1954. And some of it after the war was tougher than it was during the war because they also had to feed people in Germany, in the areas that they were looking after. So, someone like John Lennon, for instance, had never been able to go in a sweet shop and buy what he wanted until he was 14 years old. So that's what that generation went through. So they're looking for some way to define themselves as different from their parents. That's why they bought one of these. This was the thing that said, you know what, old man, I'm sick and tired of hearing about what you did in the frigging war. This is me. I'm this guy, okay? See ya.
Fucking
and that's,
hell.
That's how it goes. It's punk rock. It's
and, you know,
rock.
That's why one of the first Beatles B-sides, it was, can I have a quarter of strawberry bonbons, please?
Yeah.
Nobody ever
actually was,
that.
Give me those quarter of strawberry bonbons, would you?
Just quickly, we're going to have a song in a minute, I can't believe it. But the V&A, the Victoria and Albert website, give a kind of Sky Sports stats on Billy Bragg at Glastonbury. For some reason, I don't quite know why. 14 performances. 1984, first played. 2022, last played. No, 2023. Give us a little insight into what it was like the first time and then what you're going to do after this. Where are we going to be able to see you next?
When I first played, it was all fields around here. I have to say it once
Naughty
a day,
boy.
Otherwise I'm not. No, it was basically the pyramid stage, and then there was another stage, the NME stage, and there was a theatre tent. So it was having a vibe there. But what it was back then, I first played in 83, I think it was, the revival was 82. It was the place where everybody who's pissed off with Margaret Thatcher came to gather. You know, the CND logo on the stage was like a beacon to all of us. You know, 84 was the year of the miners' strike. That was very big here. The years that followed with the convoy. You know, anybody who was involved in kind of that kind of action gathered here. And that spirit is still around, I think. You know, the fact that there's no corporate sponsorship, they're still, you know, sending funds to WaterAid, to Greenpeace, and to Oxfam. And what other festival can you think of that has a year off to let the grass grow? I mean, you know, there's something else here, and it's, you know, it's basically Michael Leavis' nonconformist background.
Yeah.
You know, sort of like believing that there's more to it than just, you know, putting on a gig is great, but there's something beyond that. And, you know, and we all try and be part of that. We all try and live up to that down at left field. You know, obviously we've got the politics and all that. But also, you know, if they say up at the top, that they want to get a gender balance on the stage, we do our best to do that. You know, if they say we're going to get rid of plastic cups, we do our best to do that. And I play a lot of festivals, you don't get that. Most festivals, you turn up, you play, thank you very much, goodbye. You know, down at left field, we encourage our bands to camp with us for the weekend. We've got a little bit of room backstage because we want them to sit in our green room and talk to the political people who are coming in, because we're looking for bands, not bands that are artists that are capital P politics, because their experience is so different from mine. You know, I was, you know, politicised by the miner strike. You can't expect young artists who haven't been through something like that to write the sort of songs. All right, but that doesn't mean they can't write about the things that they feel strongly about. So what we're looking for is people that write about the pressure that they feel under. That's as political as anything to me. It doesn't have to be about unions. It doesn't have to be about socialism. It just has to be about the pressure that you feel. That's what punk was about. That's what skiffle was about. So that spirit, what I wanted to say was that spirit has carried on. I still feel that here. It's a different vibe here. And people know that. And that's why, you know, in 2 weeks' time, I'm playing at the Shrewsbury Folk Festival, which is a lovely folk festival, a really lovely festival. And I've played there before and it's great. But you go there and you come home and you say what you did at the weekend. Oh, I was at Shrewsbury Folk Festival. People will be like, oh, no. But you come home and you drop the G bomb. Everyone's like, whoa, you know. So there's not many festivals that have managed to sustain that for 50 years.
It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. Billy Bragg, ladies and gentlemen, though, the heart and soul of it. Yeah. And I've asked to close this little section with you, Billy, because you've got many other things to do. You very kindly asked what song we might like to hear. And what I've requested is On the Nose. I accept that. But I know that it will make this whole place go off like a frog in a sock. And also, just wanted to quickly get your take on somebody who did a wonderful and beautiful cover version of it, Kirsty MacColl.
Bless her. Bless her. I miss her greatly, Kirsty. She's a dear, dear friend. And, you know, she would be great down at left field. She'd be a great Saturday night headliner for left field.
God, imagine.
And how great. And then she'd go out and go absolutely, she'd take us all out to get absolutely bloated somewhere. That's exactly what Kirsty would do. She'd come do the, that's what she used to do in the studio. Come in, do the vocals, and then we'd all go up the pub. Oh. And that's, you need someone like that. So I miss her greatly. Kirsty MacColl, everyone. Come on.
I think you know what's coming.
21 years when I wrote this song. I'm 22 now, but I won't be for long. People ask me, when will I grow up to be a man? But all the girls I loved at school are already pushing prime. I loved you then as I love you still. Though I put you on a pedestal, they put you on a pill. Don't feel bad about letting you go. Just feel sad about letting you go. To change the world, I'm not looking for New England, just looking for another girl. I don't want to change the world, I'm not looking for New England, just looking for another girl. I love the words you wrote to me, but that was bloody yesterday. Can't survive on what you sing. Every time you need a friend, I saw two shooting stars last night. I wished on them. Did wrong to wish on Spice Hardware. I wish, I wish, I wish you'd care. I don't want to change the world. I'm not looking for looking for another girl. I don't want to change the world. I'm not looking for New England. I'm just looking for another girl. We're going to sing a verse for Kirsty as well? I think we are, yeah. My dreams were full of strange ideas. My mind was set despite the fears. Other things got in the way. Once upon a time at home, I sat beside the telephone, waiting for someone to pull me through. When I lost it, didn't ring, I knew it wasn't you. I don't want to change the world. I'm not looking for New England. I'm just looking for another girl. novel girl. Looking for a novel girl. Thank you very much.
Billy Bragg, come on. Come on. Come on. You're going to not see better than that this weekend. Come on. Watching Sean Keaveney's Community Garden Radio. Give it up once again for Billy Bragg. Oh yes, my name is Matt Everett. I'm standing in for Sean for a minute while he goes to relieve himself. It's an honour to be back on the show. We have got some more guests. In fact, we've got another guest now. Obviously, like, one of the great joys of my job is I get to interview really, really influential figures from the world of art, culture, music and so on and so on. I'm very pleased to welcome to a very special guest for Community Garden Radio. We're going to have a bit of an interview to talk about his career. Obviously, he's been in the news kind of late, as you'll find out in a minute. So please give it up for King Charles! Topless King Charles, for some reason that's not been explained.
It's so ruddy hot, Mark. Apparently the pigs back at Sandringham are extremely hot, even in their air-conditioned barn.
Good afternoon, Your Majesty.
Good afternoon, Mark. Thank you very much for coming today.
And I mean, have you been since getting the big job?
Oh, the big job. Well, I must say it's been lovely out there, you know, to meet the subjects and finally get on with some things I really believe in. As you know, Mark, I'm very passionate about the environment. And one of the first things I did upon becoming king was have wildflower seeds distributed to thousands of schools in the United Kingdom.
It's a lovely idea.
Yes, I thought so, yes. As far as I know, that's the first time a member of our royal family has distributed their seeds to school-aged kids. And of that, I'm extremely proud. You know, very proud. Bloody pen.
I mean, you have... I must say, you've got so many properties all over the land. Sandringham, Buckingham Palace, Windsor Castle. Which is your favourite?
Oh, well, yes, good question. Of course, Mark. We are hugely privileged to have all these homes, and each has their charm, as you can imagine. But I had to choose... If I had to choose an absolute favourite, I think I'd probably go for the two-bed that Camilla and I have in Brixton. It's lovely. We love nothing more than rolling out of bed around 12, you know, scoring an 8th, and going to Brockwell Park with a boombox with 8 red stripes. You know, it's a lovely way to spend the day, you know. Then we go down to the fridge and get mashed. Mashed. Listening to some Fat Garage. Yeah.
It's Brian Ferry as well, isn't it?
Really? Yes, it is. Okay. Very loud, isn't it? Very loud.
King
Avalon.
Your Majesty, quite controversially, your organisation, the Prince's Trust, removed Philip Schofield as the patron recently due to his admitted sexual relations with a young person.
Yes, absolutely. Well, I'm afraid that would come up, but it was the only course of action we could take. Of course, we've all loved Philip for many years. I preferred him to Prince Philip, to be honest. Schof never called me a useless prick, you know. He's been a constant, reassuring white presence in the media for years, like yourself and Paul Hollywood, you know. But his antics in the broom cupboard got him to the top of the TV tree, but sadly, his antics in the broom cupboard also had him facing the sack, which I believe the young lad was in the broom cupboard at one point. We in the royal family are expected to uphold the highest standards of propriety, Mark, and could never countenance even the slightest whiff of sexual impropriety.
Some would argue that after recent revelations in the royal family, putting the word prince and trust in the same sentence is, while talking about sexual conduct, is a bit of a joke.
I'm sorry, Mike, what are you talking about?
What about your brother?
Edward? Well, Sophie's a grown woman. She's consensual.
Not Edward.
Anne's not a man. She's a woman.
No, Andrew.
Never heard of him. Anyway, the point is we're planting thousands of hectares of new forest in many parts of the country. Yeah. Thank you very much for clearing that one up.
Can we speak of another controversy, please?
Christ, it's like Piers Morgan's bloody excuse, isn't it? Go on, hit me with it. I'm ready.
So for many years, since Diana was still alive, people in the press have been speculating that Harry was not your son. Would you please address this for once and for all?
Well, okay, thank you, Mark, for giving me the opportunity to address this in the best possible forum, which I'm sure all would agree is publicly, in front of a tentful of strangers, some of whom are on mushrooms. But you're right to bring it up. I'm the king, and this is a public interest issue. I have to tell you that the news is difficult. What I'm about to say is very upsetting, but it's true. Harry is my son. You know, Jesus Christ. I mean, Kemizel and I were bloody addicted to Suits. Have you watched Suits? It's brilliant. It makes Breaking Bad look like Waterloo Road. And Megan's fantastic in it. But now every time it comes on the TV, I just have to blast it with a fucking shotgun. I've been through 63 Trinitrons in the last 5 years.
Are you talking to Harry at the moment?
No, but we're both currently writing and recording a diss song.
Oh, right.
At the moment, yes.
He'll
be releasing his in October and mine will drop a couple of days later.
Could you give us a taste of it?
Okay, but listen, I was listening to a lot of Red Hot Chili Peppers when I wrote this, so it is in the flow of the genius Anthony Kiedis. Just to warn you, it's quite sexual. Hazard and Meg Prince and princesses, snowflake gold emperors with gold excesses. Netflix motherfuckers, telling your tale. You're so blind, you should be using Braille. Mega is pretty with an ass to die for. Has a RAF, yeah, you used to fly for. Get back in your cockpit and shut your face. The royals don't want to talk about a record on race. If you want to come at me, I'll see you in the palace. Don't expect a nice guy, I'm gonna be callous. Out of my name, boys, I prefer the bald one. Yeah, my name is King Charles and I'm the Big Daddy Royal Don.
Oh.
Yes.
Wow.
Good, isn't it? It's work in progress, obviously.
Wow.
Yes, it's very... But it's not just hard rap, you know. I do ballads as well. For instance, I've done another Prince Star Trek for Camizzle. It's called I Wanna Be Your Tampon. But it's all on the solo album. It's out in October. It's got a lot of guest musicians on it. Some of the people are here. Royal Blood, obviously. HRH from Steps. Run the Crown Jewels, and Lindsay Buckingham Palace on guitar, obviously.
It sounds great if you got... Sorry.
What?
I just keep getting distracted.
I know,
by
it's
your
big, isn't it? Oh, the nipples, yes. I mean, you weren't expecting to see the King's nipples at Glastonbury Festival this year, but now here we all are. You know what I was going to do? Write the word Vimto under here with two arrows up to the nipples.
Have you got a title for the record?
Yes, KC and the Sunshine Band. That was actually my fucking joke months ago. Oh, God. I'm sure it's been a pleasure for you all, hasn't it?
It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Your Majesty.
Yes.
It has, I mean, been a pleasure. Well, I think what would make it be even better is if you could perform your new single for us. Tell us a bit about it before you...
Well, you know, I've already dropped my flow and it's pretty hot. And, you know, there's something about becoming king that gives you the freedom to really, you know, sort of get into your real space.
Yeah.
So this is my version of Bonkers.
Okay.
So I'm gonna, if you could just reach around for a moment, don't worry, I'm not Prince Andrew. Thank you so much, to Mr. Matt Every, for doing that wonderful, wonderful.
And King Charles.
King Charles, yes, I mean, that's even bigger, isn't it? Thank you, Matt Everett. Okay, come on, put your hands together. I hope I come in at the right point or else I'm going to completely fuck it up. I wake up every day, it's a daydream. It's like a Roddy Downton Abbey scene. I wake up just to go back to sleep. My younger brother is a real bad creep. All I care about is Dutch cheap products. My wife looks like Audrey Roberts. Everybody says I gotta get a grip. Or the monarchy will give me the slip. Some people think I'm bonkers, cause I talk to a tree. Man, I'm just living my life, there's nothing crazy about me. Some people pay for thrills, but I get mine for free. Man, I'm just loving my wife, she looks like Audrey Roberts to me. Yes, you know this, come on, join in. I get drove round in a big Rolls Royce. I have to talk to paupers, I got no choice. Wanna spit bars and show my flow, but I gotta go and up a flower show. I own most of this country, motherfucker, most of it belongs to me. Now get off my fucking land, or you're gonna feel the back of my hand, laddie. Bonkers. Some people think I'm bonkers, cause I talk to a tree. Man, I'm just living my life, there's nothing crazy about me. Man, I just think I'm bonkers, cause I get mine for free. Man, I'm just loving my life, she looks like Audrey Roberts to me. Bounce, ladies and gentlemen. I look like a DJ now, don't I?
Blondie at Glastonbury Community Garden Radio. Congratulations for being here, for being at one of the ultimate happenings, I think. They used to have happenings a lot in the 60s, and then they fucked them off, you know. But don't even look at our next guest, because they're not here yet. This is an illusion. You've all been taking too much peyote. Who started the mushroom tea? It's almost like you can see a guest setting up beside me, but he's not there. He's a pigment of your imagination. They are a pigment of your imagination. Quickly, I'm going to do a quick roll call of some of the people that are here. Right, let's have a bit of... Freya Clegg. Fabian Cornwell. Clive Tullow. I can't believe he's put himself in the station manager. It is still a thrill getting a shout out on the radio, even though I'm on the radio. I prefer hearing other people say, Sean Keaveney's listening at the moment. We'll play some Dire Straits for him in a minute. Kelly Magoo! Osh Tivan! Who got told to fuck off by Colin Farrell, let's not forget. In a chicken shop. Beth Finesilver, make yourself known. Come on, the heart and soul of Glastonbury, along with Billy Bragg. Isabel Barrett. Sam Brugger. Scott Hancock. Emily Hancock. Hannah Crawford. Andy Saunders, bringing the lager. And Simon Benham. Not Venom, that would be weird. Okay, let's just a little bit of news that we need to talk about. Because you know that we are, I mean, we were voted also, like, just above Have I Got News For You, the best satirical comedy programme in the United Kingdom just 2 weeks ago. That's bollocks, but it sounds good, doesn't it? We've got to address the elephant in the room, okay? And you've seen me with my top off, I'm not talking about me. Political aides who worked with Boris Johnson during the Partygate scandal. Can we get a boo, like a really performative pantomime boo for Boris? That was excellent, really full-throated. You could hear Billy's boo, and he's already quite near the pyramid stage. So, I mean, and also Johnson's honours list are playing at the West Holtz stage at 2:50 on tomorrow afternoon. But it is a ridiculous thing, isn't it? Charlotte Owen, a former advisor to Johnson, who graduated in 2015, is going to become the youngest ever life peer. Can you believe? Which is ridiculous. Priti Patel. She's been given a damehood for her services to weaponising hate, intolerance and xenophobia, whilst Jacob Rees-Mogg has received a sirship for being a distracting caricature posh cartoon cunt. I didn't realise this until the day before yesterday. Boris Johnson's hairdresser has received a damehood. Kelly Dodge, the appropriately named. But we work very hard here at Community Garden Radio. We've got a team of journalists, and we've actually found the full list. Because you know that Rishi Sunak knocked a few off. Do you want to know who they are? These are the people that Johnson was trying to get through. Vladimir Putin. Katie Hopkins. The Sheriff of Nottingham. Doesn't even exist. Disgraced former lottery winner Michael Carroll. The guy who invented covering individual pieces of fruit in plastic in supermarkets. A guy that went to Rishi Sunak's primary school and pantsed him in front of assembly. Andrew and Tristan Tate. A man called Herman who used to deliver katsu curry to Boris Johnson's office on Thursdays. And then he was going to try and add Vigo, you know, the one more time hi-vis guy who won Britain's Got Talent. But those were the ones that didn't get through. But there you go. And I think one more, just to bookend it, a colossal boo for the Conservative Party, unless, of course, you're a Conservative voter. One, two, three. It's on the nose, but it's cathartic. Okay? Now, obviously, you don't know this, because how could you possibly know? But imminently, we've got a very special guest, and you're going to be thrilled to hear them. But next, I'm going to play a little bit of... Let's have a look. Oh, I know what I'm going to play. This is this kind of song that always goes down beautifully. It is Ventura Highway. Summer vibes, kids.
say, this town don't look good in snow. You don't care, I know. Ventura Highway in the sunshine, where the days are longer, the nights are stronger than
chatting and drinking. That's an awful suggestion. Awful suggestion. I simply won't have it. Are you having a good time? I realise that that is a really reductive thing to shout at a festival audience, but what can you do when you're trying to multitask and you can't? Ladies and gentlemen, for your delectation, you've already seen on this stage King Charles, Matt Everett, right? Billy Bragg. Could you please give it up for one of the greatest, sort of linguistically terrifyingly brilliant beatboxers, performers, musicians that I've ever had the absolute pleasure of sharing a stage with? Could you give it up colossally for Shlomo? So just, listen, how many times would you reckon you've done Glastonbury?
I added it up on the way here. This is my 13th, and if you include the live streams we did in lockdown, it's my 14th. This is home. Who feels like this is home? Wait, who's been here before? Who's a Virgie? Who's not been here?
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
I mean, a couple of Virgies. Okay? You're right. Anyone? We look after them. They might need some extra hugs. It's just, I still can't ever believe it. I've been here since Wednesday, and I just keep being like, we're at Glastonbury. It's like, yes, Shlo. That has been established by now.
How do you do it? How do you approach it? Do you take it easy? Are you a Greenfields guy? I know that you're not a participant in the crazy stuff anymore. You know, do you see it almost as a holiday in a sense?
I very much do participate in the crazy stuff. I'm 14 years clean and sober, everybody. thank you, but I still get... Are we allowed to swear?
Yeah.
I still get fucking high.
Hey!
Just on all the love and the dancing and the sexy people out there and the sunshine. It's just such an experience. So I don't know, last year, I only had one show on the Wednesday, and then I just like got lost in the ocean of this incredible place. This year, I'm doing quite a few extra bits, but I'm nearly done, and then we can just go party. It's so, look at you lot, you're all just like,
whoop, whoop, Scotty, whoop, whoop, Scotty, whoop. Okay, well, I think that it's time for us to unleash our talent on these incredibly fortunate people.
Are you sure they do not look ready?
All right, well, they will be ready. They're never going to be ready, so you just got to do it sometimes, haven't you? Shlo, what are you going to... I'm not even going to say what you're going to do. Do what you're going to do. I'm going to stand aside like I've lit a firework.
I'm going to EMT. I'm going to unleash my talent on you lot. How we doing? I'm very, very happy to be here. I don't know if any of you've ever come across a human like myself. I am a very much non-binary pronouns type person. My pronouns are they, them, if that's okay with you. If that's not okay with you, those are still my pronouns. And I have my... Do you know what this thing is, guys? This thing's called a sunflower lanyard. This means I have a hidden disability. Any other disabled people here? Yay, it's not really that accessible a place, is it? I have autism and ADHD. Ironically, there used to be a little bit of card on there that said I have severe ADHD and might get lost. Ironically, that piece of card has now been lost. And I recently found myself at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival where they now do an award ceremony for neurodiversity. I got asked to present an award at the Neurodiverse Awards. I was so proud. They said, Shlo, we want you to present the ADHD award. I was like, thank you. But what do you mean present the award? Do you not mean collect it? And they said, no, Shlomo, this is the ADHD comedy award. I said, fair. I'm not a comedian. I'm a beatboxer. Beatboxer. They're like, that's nothing. Hey, Glastonbury, who here knows what beatboxing is? Raise your hand if you've heard about beatboxing before. Who here's ever tried beatboxing before? Wait, why did your hands go down there? We've all heard you in a fucking shower. I am a beatboxer. That means I make music with my mouth. It's incredibly good fun. It's incredibly portable. And I want to tell you, gang, a little story, because people always want to ask me every time they see me perform. They ask me the same questions. They say, dude, when did you find out you could do that with your mouth? As if I kind of woke up last Thursday, did a slightly painful sneeze, and discovered that in my sleep I'd magically transformed into superstar beatbox human. I mean, thank you. That's very kind of you to applaud for my imaginary painful origin story, but that is not how I became a superstar beatboxer. I've been doing this a long time, since I was very small. In fact, I've always been a performer. My parents, my mum claims to have video footage of me aged 3 years old belly dancing at my grandmother's party. I can explain. When I was small, there used to be a very big Iraqi Jewish community based in North London, and my nana, the self-appointed queen of this world, used to host these huge parties. Picture a small brown lady about this tall, and if you ever hear this sound, you know it's going to be a fucking good night. That's Nana. She's kind of intense, which is why you should meet the antidote over here, is my grandpa, the most chilled out human being in the history of Edgeware. He will just sit here for hours at a time, radiating happiness and clicking together his worry beads. It's like a little string of beads. All the old Middle Eastern men sit there with them. It's like they hadn't invented ADHD fidget toys yet. For the benefit of the audience listening on the radio, I just looped my voice using a loop station. So there's Grandpa clicking on the beads to alleviate his stresses about the camels or whatever. And I remember one of my earliest childhood memories, sitting transfixed for hours whilst my grandpa plays this small Arabic drum called a dumbug. He only plays one rhythm, but he plays it well. Kind of sounds like this. Da, so listen, my nana's parties, we always get there first, and you know something's going to happen because all the chairs have been laid out around the outside of the room and the smell of the Arabic food is to die for. And then your aunties start arriving. For some reason, there are hundreds of these ancient human beings who call themselves aunties, and every single one of them wants to queue up to pinch your cheeks as hard as she possibly can and tell you, haven't you grown into the most beautiful human being that ever lived? Which after a while, you can start to believe. And then the band starts playing. There's always a proper live Arabic band at Nana's parties. My darlings, do you want to hear the sound of the Arabic band? Wait, I just want to check something. I know probably not that many of you might be Arabic Jews. No? That's fine, you are still allowed to enjoy it. Would you like to hear the sound of the Arabic bands? Okay, let me show you this. Sure, everyone's having a good time. Every single person in the room has to be laughing, joking, drinking, clapping their hands. But you know what? That's not going to be enough for my nana. One by one, she goes around the room. She grabs you by both of your wrists and she pulls you to your feet until every single human in the room is on their feet. Until every single human in the room is on their feet. So, here's me. When all of a sudden, out comes the dancer, professional belly dancer, all the way from fucking Egypt or somewhere. All my aunties are going, dance, darling, dance, slow-mo, like something possessed. And I'm thinking, maybe my time has come. Maybe this is it. Like, whoop, 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 whoop. Fucking love you. My name is SK Shlomo. I'm going to be performing on the Park stage shortly. I'm on the Park stage at 10 past 6, I think it is. I'll see you there. Hey, Sean, thank you so much.
That'd be nice to get some air to those buttocks, though.
Fuck it, I'm going to stand up as well. Why not? S.K. Shlomo. I mean... I knew they were a talent, but I think we've been a bit blessed today. And I was just saying to Simon backstage, who runs the whole Free University concept, which I think you'll agree is a pretty lovely thing at the top of the festival. You know, we've been very moved, actually. Been very moved. And when Billy did his song, I actually had a little cry, as did Simon. And I've not even started on the mushroom chocolate yet. That wasn't my fault, that little drop that you heard there. Has anybody got bingo yet? You still waiting? Yeah. Ah, Kim Bruce, Greatest Hits Radio. Top 10 of 10. And after that, of course, 3 and 10 for Faith No More. 3 and 10 for Faith No More. Caffeine, Midlife Crisis. I'm afraid you're out of time. Okay, let's have a really familiar bed and let's pretend that we're in Hawaii.
Shall we?
In a bit, I know you're not going to believe this, but we have another guest. Colossal apologies to the gardeners at home who are just thinking, well, I'm getting off this is fucking FOMO. But you are also getting Shlomo. You can do better than that. I can't. You know what as well? I have dropped a pill. I dropped it about 3 hours ago. It's my ADHD medication. But I'm not really coming up on it. So that you might notice that, actually. Let's have a little look here. I was going to do a feature with you, like a little game show called Play Your Carbs Right. And I was just going to hold up carbs, and then you had to guess if it was higher and lower in carb content than the croissant before. But we haven't got time to do that. And in a bit, somebody is going to win the last ever Community Garden Radio grey t-shirt. I mean, that's the new blankety blank checkbook and pen right there, isn't it? But just very quickly, as anybody, you must know, I must tell you about, this is a genuine thing, and I think we may have missed them once, but there is a musical collective called the Master Musicians of Jujuka. Do you know about these guys? I think they might even be playing here. Are they playing here? Simon's like, don't fucking know. I don't think so. Me and Kerris Matthews came up here to watch them perform in 2011. It's one of the most spectral, hypnotising, beautiful things you will ever see. Why am I still standing up when everybody else has sat down? I'm 51, you know. I shouldn't be standing up. Fucking hell. I've got mobility issues here. If you get the chance to see them, see them. There are about 50 musicians. They play music that's like 1,000 years old. And they play trance, proper, actual trance music. It's like they'll play a riff for 90 minutes. And so... for the first, like, 3 or 4 minutes, you're thinking, nah. And then about another 7 or 8 minutes of it, and you're thinking, you're taking the piss, mate. You're taking the piss. Have you heard of Chuck Berry? Another 2, 3 or 4, or 10 minutes, you're in a fucking trance, and they've got you by the balls, they've got you by the gender titles. But they've just done a set, apparently. I've just been told halfway through some people weren't paying much attention. So one of the lads shouted, "We are the Master Musicians of Jujuka, and this is Jabali Souf trance music." That was actually a Royal Blood reference. But they're playing here at 10 p.m. tonight. I'll see you here. I'll see you here at moonlight, staring at the North Star, wondering if somebody's nicked my car. So what we're going to do is... we'll have another song, and then do you think you've got enough bandwidth for one more guest? Okay, they're quite high profile. It's been quite difficult for us to get them to the top of the hill here. In 2013, I managed to get Brian Cox and Matt Smith, the current Doctor Who, up here, and it was bedlam. Do you remember? It was almost dangerous, but we've managed to sneak this person in via copter. Are you ready for it? Are you sure? Well, let me tell you something. It's definitely not Sir Elton John, right?
listen, I'm very sorry about this. But I heard we were a bit over-enthusiastic last night. We erected the tents, and then we had a few rums, and got a very sloppy falafel in the green fields, and it's not been sitting well. How would Sean Connery say that? It's not been sitting well. So I pass the time in here. Can I introduce our next guest to the Crow's Nest stage? A woman who was at least partially responsible for Boris Johnson's massive, swollen majority, a prolific writer of fiction, obviously. Anybody who's read her biography or recent Daily Mail pieces will attest to that. A working-class warrior, levelling down, lost lady of the Lords. Oh, here to sing her heart out. Take your time. To the man she loved. It's the no right dishonourable Nadine Dorries.
Dirty. Dirty bastard. Guess you had me when you said Brexit. When you stepped down right out of that bus. You fuck the poor. Maybe you could fuck me too. I'm hopelessly devoted to you. I know I'm a fool who's willing, it's a quick verse that, to stoke your massive culture war. Join me on Talk TV and everyone will see the truth. I'm hopelessly devoted to you. Not you, you. But now there's no fridge in to hide. I've cried and cried and cried. Did Putin really ring you up and really say that he would nuke you? Oh, I'd take a massive bomb for you, Boris. Oh, a big warhead he's got, you should see it. I'd take a massive bomb for you. I'm talking to you, love. I wanna be your Jennifer Acuri. For you I'd say the black was white. Let's just face the truth. For you I would talk endless shite. I'm hopelessly devoted to you. Like Boris used to.
Shard and able to that
to you. Don't worry, the set's nearly done. Ben, play a fucking song, mate. And anyway, Boris, what about that? You love that. Fucking Billy Bragg, though, he's so woke. Why did you get Lawrence Fox on instead? He's got some lovely acoustic songs, you know. Fucking hell. Anyway, bye bye, Nadine. Bye bye. See you in a bit.
Best you've heard, and you can choose.
You like that? You like that?
Are you okay? I hope so.
Let's have that again.
Are you okay? I hope so.
What's the opposite of disingenuous? It's so genuous, that, isn't it? Well, anyway.
Genuine. Are you okay? I hope so.
Can't get enough of it. Can't get enough of it, Ben. Somebody stop me.
So should we...
Ladies and gentlemen, by the way, thank you so much to Nadine Dorries for stepping into the lion's den, really, because it's, you know, it is, let's be honest, I don't know. I think if you threw a shoe here, you probably wouldn't hit a GB News viewer. Unlike in certain parts of the country, of course, but she's great. And for the people at home listening, backstage, you know when you play a great football match, you've won or you've lost, and you swap shirts, and that's what Nadine and I have done. So I actually come on in her hot pink trouser suit, and the funny thing about that is that there's no fucking way I'm taking this off for the rest of the weekend. Because it's so unbelievably comfortable. There's air going, I mean, there's so much circulation. It's unreal. Lads, you should try it. We're coming...
Give your meat a good old rub.
I think it's... We're shuddering towards a head-throwing back climax here. But before we do, I just want to again say thanks to the Crow's Nest guys for making this such a genuinely pleasurable place to be. The Free University of Glastonbury. There's so much brilliant stuff on here all weekend. You've simply got to be here. Such a lovely vibe. To station manager Clive, to Kitty. But, I mean, I don't want to start getting sexual.
I just kind of, when I see a hole, I want to stick my finger in it.
And I don't want you to be objectifying him just because he's a man in his 20s and he's good looking. Oh, that's nice. Oh, yeah. But he's my man. He's my man. He's my one and only man. Baby. No, keep it going. When I first saw you, it was 2014 and you were 16. And I didn't have any sexual thoughts, I want you to know, because that would be illegal. But I want to tell you, Ben, I love you so. We planted the seeds together and we watched them grow. You got legs to die for, you got an ass to die for, that's so true. But inside, there's the real you. I love you so. My producer, Ben. A round of applause for Ben, please, right now. Okay. Nobody saw that
coming. That wasn't planned at all.
It's amazing, actually. You get a bit of Barry White beneath your wings and you can do anything, can't you? You miss him every day. Okay. What we're going to do is, I think, we're going to finish, we're going to try and give away these prizes.
Yeah, bingo. I think we need to...
Don't look up there. Just try and stay focused. Don't look up the culotte.
So, just, has anyone got bingo yet? Has anyone won away?
What about if
You've
we
got
do...
one.
What about if we do... Let's fire a few off. Hang on.
Pacino?
I'm not the sort of person that people throw pies
okay,
at.
Okay, Oh, I'm 82 years old, and I've been fucking gifted a child, motherfuckers, okay? Say hello to my little friend, okay? He's fucking tiny, okay? I'm gonna call him Corleone, and I'm sitting here changing his dirty ass. Why don't you fucking change your own ass, you asshole? Fucking changing his ass, covered in white powder all over the fucking place. I got a machine gun in one hand, my wife can't even help me. Al Pacino, ladies and gentlemen. Oh my God. So, it was my birthday, of course. Unfortunately, I've been indicted. I'm so indicted and I just can't hide it. I'm about to lose control and I don't think I like it. But of course, I share my birthday with Mike Yarwood and Boy George
And also Sean Keaveney. So Melania is
yesterday
a...
Yesterday's a hard word.
Yesterday is a hard word. I want you to try and say it. I want you to try and say yesterday. Yesterday. Exactly, it's a hard word. That's what I just said. It's a hard word. Yesterday's a hard word.
Is that Johnny Cash?
Johnny Cash on Quaaludes. Right. So how are we going to give these fuckers
away?
No
one at bingo.
Got no bingo. It's fallen flat on its tits.
Let's start going through.
Right, okay. Let's have a look. What I'm going to do is, should I just read these out?
Read these out.
Dead Air. Has anybody got Dead Air? Has anybody got Sean Says Apposite? I've not done that until now. Has anybody, I say the word juncture? A mention of Led Zeppelin, of course. Jimmy Page, a good friend of mine, I saw him in Sister Ray in Soho in 2014. He was buying, a Sid we need. He was buying a Howling Wolf record. And I walked in. This is a true story. I just interviewed him a few weeks before. It's the only reason he knew me. Walked into this record shop. This is a small claim. Wasn't expecting to see Jimmy Page because I had Led Zeppelin's The Song Remains the Same on my headphones. Walked in, he's fucking there buying a Howling Wolf record. And he span round like that and he went, Sean! And that was the moment at which I died and went to heaven. Everything since then has been a... There you go. Wrong one. Orange Man of Positivity, Onions, I Should Drink Less, Lee. We got a bingo? We got a house? A line. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, we have a winner. This is fantastic, and it's also an epochal moment because this is the last grey Community Garden Radio T-shirt. It's essentially like if you roll the Elgin marbles in with Picasso's fucking Guernica, that's what this is, ladies and gentlemen. A massive round of applause. Ellen, come up and receive your prize. I don't have to check. I'm not that kind of dickhead. We're going to have one more song. And then we're going to finish this bastard with the Hill Street Blues.
The 80s. Interest rates are at 15%. The Conservatives are in charge. They've started the Falklands War just to fucking confuse us. Maggie's having a chat with Ronald Reagan. They've decided to fuck the planet. But Duran Duran at the top of the charts. Enjoy.
Okay. Oh, that's enough of that. It's actually, I just realised that's not a song, it's actually a bed. So I consider that shortchanging the audience. Right, we're going to finish, right? But before we do, I've written a song about Glastonbury. And I wondered if you might like to hear it. That was tepid at best, wasn't it, Ben? The world's greatest musical talent, all in one place, and Sean Keaveney. Well, you know what? In my defence, I bet none of these fuckers this weekend have got a song, because the Water Boys aren't here, are they? They've got a Glastonbury song. I bet none of the other fuckers have. Oh, all right, apart from Beans on Toast, don't forget about that. Why do you have to do that? You know, Stefflon Don's not going to come on and do a song about Glastonbury. I can tell you that for nothing. Arctic Monkeys aren't going to come. Hey, Glastonbury, they're not going to do it. We were the only game in town, us and Beans on Toast. So, actually, Ben, the only thing I've not got is my lyrics. Look at Ben's... Get the guitar. We've actually... Has everybody got a copy of the lyrics? Now, obviously, there's not much point handing out lyrics to a song you don't know. I accept that
is an intellectual non sequitur. But if you feel it's such a catchy tune, you feel like joining in, do it. Right. Here we go. This is actually a remodeled mosque song from 1988. It was originally called Canterbury. Don't know why we sang a song about Canterbury. It was something about Robert Runcie and something like that. And William of Sems. But here is a song, ladies and gentlemen, you'll be singing not just for the rest of the weekend, but for the rest of your life. I've not bothered tuning up. Take a bus to Glastonbury, drink flat ale in Glastonbury, do some drugs in Glastonbury, eat a falafel at Glastonbury. Come for the tunes and the ley lines, right down the M4. Get slow, pack it past Tonehenge, visit Glastonbury Tour. Come on! Don't take kids to Glastonbury, eat some mushrooms at Glastonbury, talk to a police horse at Glastonbury, get the fear in Glastonbury. Feel one with the planet at the stone circle at night. Imagine you're a caveman. Look over there, is that Tom York? Make new friends at Glastonbury, make new friends at Glastonbury, see old rockers at Glastonbury, share some joints with a man called Terry. Michael and Emily Evis, they don't make lots of dosh, they give a lot to Greenpeace with their pyramid scheme. Go be woke at Glastonbury, have a toke at Glastonbury, not many bellends at Glastonbury, Ivy Tilsley was Lynn Perry. It's good, that. There you go, you're welcome.
Right, one more song.
Don't worry, we're nearly there. You've done so well. light pours out of me, out of my culotte, into the sea of humanity at Glastonbury. I think that it's been great, you know. I think we're done. I think that, I don't know if we passed the audition, but what I would say is that we've put in a lot of effort, and I think it was a sterling opportunity to show everybody what Community Garden Radio is about. And eventually, it all comes down to a 51-year-old man drunk on Kraken, smoking joints, in a hot pink trouser suit gifted to him by Nadine Dorris. The only way we can finish any of my programmes is by using a very, very special and triggering piece of music. It's going to happen. Not that one.
I can't find it.
You can't find it? After that lament, after that incredibly sexual love song that I just played you, you can't... Come on, you know it. Hill Street Blues. Hill Street Blues. Hill Street Blues, it's bloody Hill Street Blues. That's it. Listen, don't look up there. It has actually been emotional for us. I mean, to have the... Look at this Yes Bab here. We've got the youngest member of the Community Garden Radio audience with us here. Hello, you. The next generation. The generation that is going to repair the shite that this Conservative administration have put us in. Actually, that's quite a lot to put on a baby. I retract that. It's not all down to that child. He does look very capable, though, this child. Listen, thanks each and every one of you for coming all the way up the hill on a very hot day. I would just like to thank everybody who is involved in Community Garden Radio again, all the patrons. Give it a try if you haven't already. This is where I do my like pyramid selling bit. And remember that you can cancel at any time. But it is an ever-burgeoning and growing and verdant garden, and it's all thanks to people like you. I hope you have a phenomenal rest of the festival, and I kiss you each figuratively, if not literally, on both cheeks. We all remember COVID. We probably better not actually, you know, the moving of spit around the entire auditorium. But what a fantastic event we've had today. Thank you so much for being here. Oh, hang on a minute. The bed's not finished yet. Rimshot. Go forth. Multiply if you must. That's what tents are made for, especially if you've got a blackout one. But whatever you do, stay safe. Don't take too many drugs. Always rehydrate. And always read the label. Please remember that. You should always read the label. Let's be careful out there. Always read the label. I can't stress that enough. Especially with non-prescription drugs. Always read the fucking label. And let me remind you of something else. If you get the fear, at any time this weekend, if at any moment you're overwhelmed, if at any moment, for whatever reason, dehydration, you've not put enough sun cream on, you've taken too many mushrooms, for whatever reason, you're feeling upset, you're feeling sad, you're feeling worried, don't fucking come to me for advice. Okay? Let's finish this off.
It's Hill Street, Hill Street, Hill Street Blues.
Thank you, Matt Everett. Thank you, Billy Bragg. Thank you to Shlomo. Thank you, Nadine Dorries. Thank you, King Charles. But most of all, thank you. Thanks very much. Have a great rest of the festival. We might as well put one more song on, hadn't we? What? No, that's a cracker. Bit of Loyal Karna. Who's going watching Loyal Karna this weekend? Yes, I'll see you at the front or at the back, actually. I'm quite old. Thank you so much, guys. I'd say I'm getting changed, but I'm not.
I'm OP. please, we ain't got no peas, because we spent all our money on some OCDs. It's like, oh please, we ain't got no peas, because we spent all our money on some OCDs. We're saying, oh please, we ain't got no peas, because we spent all our money on some OCDs. We got some old Jay-Z's, couple ODBs, place them up in perfect order, because my OCD won't let me keep it. I never speak it.